And good morning, Ajahn.
Good morning, Chow An, Selamat pagi.
How is your breakfast?
Ah, delicious.
Is it bagus? Not bagus.
No, it was bagus, but not sakali.
Good morning, Ajahn, from excellent. Singapore.
Good morning, Auntie. Nice to hear your voice again. Excellent. Any announcements to make? No announcements. Are you all still there?
Yes, I've
done. Okie dokie. So, if everyone is sitting comfortably, then I may begin. Is that a good idea? Okay, unless you interrupt me, because you can unmute me whenever you want. So if I tell any really, really bad jokes, you can always press my mute button and mute me. But anyway, I'm not sure if you know that, because yesterday was Christmas. Do you know why Santa Claus likes to do lots and lots of gardening? Santa Claus's favorite hobby when he's not packing presents is gardening, because he likes to go ho, ho, ho. Oh, you know, hoeing in the garden. Oh, okay. I think you should have muted me.
Dear me.
You should have muted me. I gave you the chance.
Okay, try a better joke.
Better one.
You got one more go to save your reputation.
No, my reputation's already short. I think you know that. Well, it's not the joke, but I wanted to talk about the five hindrances today. And I think this is a story. I wrote it in one of my books, and it's a wonderful story to start the day, to make it nice and light, and then we'll go to more serious stuff afterwards. But that's the story of the monkey, and the monkey who went to the temple on Vaisak day, knowing there were so many people there, somebody's going to drop something, and the little monkey can take that piece of fruit and have something to eat that day. But anyway, as he was in the big temple with hundreds of people and lots of busyness, he heard one of the monks giving a talk. And the monk was giving a talk on the hindrances and the problems with meditation. And the monk was talking about the monkey mind. Because this was a monkey visiting the temple, the monkey thought, well, that concerns me. I'm interested. What is this monkey mind that this monk is talking about? When the monkey heard that the monkey mind is a very bad mind, it causes so much difficulties and problems, and it makes the owner of that monkey mind never be able to meditate, never be able to be still, never be able to see the truth, but just think so many things. The monkey mind said, hey, that is defamatory. This is our modern world, and you can't stigmatize or be just so cruel to monkeys. I've got a monkey mind, said the monkey, obviously. There's nothing wrong with it. Monkey minds are good. We all have monkey minds if we're monkeys. So the monkey was very upset. So how can these Buddhist monks sort of defame us? It's libelous, it's unfair. It's a modern world, we've got to be very careful what we say to others and how we talk to other people, even monkeys. So the monkey swam back to his forest and met his troop with other friends. And even the other monkeys were really upset. They were jumping up and down, complaining. What can we do? Let's take this monk to the World Wildlife Association. We can't do such things in today's world, you know, defame monkeys just because they've got monkey minds. And then the leader of the monkeys, this very old monkey, he said, now look at you all jumping and down, being restless. That is the monkey mind. You can never get any peace if you act like that. And of course, the other monkeys understood. Yeah, monkey mind, we're so restless, we can never stay still. And how can we solve that problem? And so the old monkey, the leader of the troop, said, well, look, I've been to that Buddhist temple as well. And I've seen and heard that you can overcome the monkey mind by meditating. A And all the mangas said, yes, 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 let's meditate. Yeah, we want to meditate. Let's meditate. How do we meditate? And when they stopped jumping around with a monkey mind for 5 minutes, asked the leader, how do we meditate? He said, first of all, you've got to get a very comfortable sitting posture. So go into the forest and get some leaves or some grass. We said, yes, yes, we'll get some leaves, we'll get some grass. Yeah, let's get some leaves, let's get some grass. And they were all very agitated. But anyway, they got some leaves and grass and made a nice little zafu. And they sat under the tree. And now what do we do? Now what do we do? And the head monkey said, well, you cross your legs, your right leg over your left leg. Then you put your paws in your lap, the right paw over the left paw. Straighten your backs, put your chin in, close your eyes, and watch your breathing. You know, all the monkeys did that. That was the first time ever in history that monkeys actually meditated for about 2 minutes. And then one monkey put her paw up. Excuse me, she said, excuse me. Don't you remember that we promised, we've arranged to go to the banana plantation at lunchtime to steal lots and lots of bananas for our lunch? Because the owner's a Buddhist, he's at the temple. So there's no guards on the banana plantation. And I've been thinking about that. I've been thinking about that when I'm supposed to be washing my breath. So why don't we get that out of the way first of all? We'd all go to the banana plantation. Still, we won't eat the bananas yet because it's not lunchtime. We just collect them and put them in a big heap in the middle of the jungle in our planta, in our little area. And then we can meditate. And it means I won't have to think about what I have to do next. And all the other monkeys said, yeah, I was thinking the same. Yeah, let's do that. So they all decided to get off their zafus. And they swung to the banana plantation. They stole lots and lots of bananas. Went straight to the banana plantation, stole lots of bananas and brought it back into the part of the jungle and put it in a nice heap in the center of where they were meditating. Now they've got that out of the way, they can get some peace. So they thought. So they all went back onto their zafus and they put their right leg over their left leg, their right paw over the left paw, straighten their backs, chin in, close their eyes, and started watching their breathing. Breathing in, breathing out. And they were peaceful for about 1 minute this time. And a male monkey put his hand up, said, excuse me, excuse me. I've been thinking that before we eat those bananas, we have to peel them first of all. And I can't stop thinking about peeling the bananas. So let's all peel the bananas first, get that out of the way so I don't need to think about it. We won't eat the bananas, we just peel them first of all. And all the other monkeys said, yes, great idea, brilliant idea. We'll peel the bananas first of all. We won't eat them because it's not lunchtime yet. And then we can, no need to think about it. So all the monkeys got off their cushions and they peeled those bananas, but they never ate anything yet. And after they were all peeled, they went back to their cushions, crossed their legs, right paw over their left paw, back straight, closed their eyes, chin down, and started meditating. Breathing in. Excuse me, said another monkey. He said, excuse me, that I've been thinking. You know, before we eat those bananas, there's one more thing we have to do before eating the bananas, and that is putting them in our mouth. So let's put them in our mouth. First of all, we won't eat them because it's not lunchtime. We just put them in our mouth. I've been thinking about that, and it's been disturbing my meditation. So all the other monkeys said, yeah, great idea. This meditation certainly gives you lots of insight and wisdom. So the excuse went. And so they all put a banana in their mouth. And as I said in the original story, that some monkeys put two bananas in their mouth. You know what people are like? And even one monkey put three bananas in his mouth and managed to fit them in somewhere. They didn't eat them yet, not lunchtime. So they put them in their mouths. if you can imagine monkeys with bananas in their mouths sitting down in cushions in the forest, right leg over the left leg, right paw over the left paw, back straight, eyes closed, watching the breath. As soon as all the monkeys had their eyes closed, it was amazing how fast all those bananas vanished down their throats and into their tummies. And then once they'd eaten their bananas, they got off their zafus and went off to meditate, to play around or do what monkeys do. And we call that, from that story, that is what we mean by the monkey mind. It's not just restless mind. A monkey mind is, let's get this out of the way first, and then I'll meditate. Let's get this thought completed, and then I'll be quiet. Let's figure out what I have to do to solve this problem in my business first, and then I'll meditate. And of course, we all know much better than monkeys that we will never get all the problems finished in our life. There'll always be stuff which is yet to be completed. So how can we be different than those with monkey minds, otherwise known as monkeys? And how are we different? We just realize how important meditation is, how important valuable peace is. And if we can only remember that, then it's quite easy. This is one of those other similes from a long time ago. And as I often mention to all the people I see when I look, scroll through the people watching this retreat, most of the people, you're getting on in years. And I like that. I like teaching more elderly people because your memory is not as good as the young people. So you don't remember when I last taught the simile. So I can get away with teaching it again. And that's a simile of the professor who came into the lecture theater. And he didn't say what he was doing. He just took a big glass jar out of his bag. And then he went into his briefcase again and took out a big bag of stones. And he put one stone into the jar, one after the other, until he could get no more stones in. And then he looked up at his class, and for the first time he spoke to them. A very simple question, is the jar full? And the student said, yeah, you can't get any more stones in, it's full. And the professor smiled, reached into his bag and got a bag of smaller stones, little gravelly stones. And then he managed to put those stones into the jar, shaking the jar a bit, and he managed to find lots of spaces between the big stones in which to put the small stones. When he could get no more small stones in, then he asked the class, is it full? And of course, they were onto him by now. They knew that they'd probably find some way of getting some more into that jar. So they all shook their heads saying, no, sir. And he smiled and got some fine sand in a bag out of his briefcase and poured the fine sand into that jar, shaking it. And much of that fine sand found its way in the spaces between the big rocks and the small rocks. And when he could get no more sand in, he asked another time, is the jar full? And all the class shook their head. No, sir, you'll have some other means of getting some more things into this jar. And he smiled, and his water jug, he poured the water over the sand, small rocks and big rocks into the jar, until he could get no more water into the jar. And when he'd finished, he asked the class, what does this mean to you? What am I trying to show you and prove to you? What is the purpose of this little demonstration? And because it was in a university, one of the students put their hand up and said, sir, it proves to us that no matter how busy you think you are, you can always fit something more in. He said, no, that's not what I'm teaching you. What I'm teaching you is, if you want to put the big rocks in, what we call the precious stones, they have to go in first. Everything else can fit around them. You find some way of getting all the other duties and responsibilities in. But if you want to put the precious rocks in, the big ones, please prioritize them, schedule them in first. And everything else can fit in around them. It was a wonderful little demonstration on priorities. And that's now how we overcome that monkey mind, the restlessness, is when we always think we'll get this out of the way first and then we meditate. So I've often taught that get meditation out of the way first of all. Do that first. And then all the other things you find you can fit in. I think, you know, you all know me for so many years, and I do lots of meditation, but also I do lots of other things as well, with writing books or building monasteries and traveling all over the place and looking after Buddhist societies. I do a lot of work. How do you fit that all in, Ajahn Brahm? It's because I always prioritize my meditation. Those precious rocks come first. So it does mean that when it is time to have a retreat, please give it so much value that it becomes first in the things you should be doing. And I can't resist this. It was a sort of started off as a joke, but it came out as something much more profound than a joke. And that was the story of the person calling up a monk one day, called him and got the monk on the telephone in the office and said, oh, I'm glad I got through to you. I really need a blessing at my house. Something terrible has happened. Like, I really need you to do some chanting for me. Can you please come today? And the monk replied, I'm sorry, ma'am, but I'm very busy today. And so the caller asked the monk, said, well, what are you doing, Venerable? Why are you so busy today? And the monk replied, ma'am, I'm doing nothing today. Today's my day for doing nothing. Doing nothing is really important for a monk. It's actually important for all of you. I don't think you do nothing enough in your life. I'm doing nothing today, so I can't come. And the caller was wise enough and understood what makes a good monk or makes a good nun, what makes a good layperson, to value that. And what happens is that then you can rest a bit. So because the caller understood what the monk was saying, how important it is to rest and relax, he said, oh, never mind then, Venerable Sir. Maybe I'll call you tomorrow. And so the following day, the caller, the layperson, called the monk again. He said, oh, I called you yesterday. Can you come to my house today to do that chanting? And the monk said, I'm sorry, but I'm busy again. I said, well, what are you doing today? And the monk replied, I'm doing nothing, just like yesterday. But that was your excuse yesterday for not coming. But the monk said, well, yes, that was the excuse yesterday, but doing nothing, I'm not finished yet. So when I'm finished doing nothing, then I can come to your house. And that is learning how to prioritize your rest and relaxation. Because if you learn how to rest and relax a lot, and you're very efficient at it, and it's amazing, when you go to their house afterwards, you can really zap them and do a lot more good with what you're teaching, with what you're chanting, with everything you do. So doing nothing is a really important part of life. And of course, while doing nothing, it means learning how to do nothing properly, not just do nothing outside and just start thinking and worrying or being anxious or getting fantasies inside, really being peaceful, learning just how to stop the mind, relax, meditate, and just enjoy the nothingness of the mind, otherwise known as emptiness, freedom. Of course, you know, as a monk, we learn that for so many years. This, our priorities and our values are sometimes different from the world. Because how can you give to others if you haven't got inside yourself? So learning the value of peace and emptiness and nothing, learning how to relax. And then the mind gets so incredibly peaceful. And then you have something wonderful you can share with the world. So when people start meditating, they always do too much, always thinking and worrying. And that's called, you know, monkey mind, it's called restlessness. And how do we overcome that restlessness? As a young monk, when I was training, I'd always flip between the two hindrances of restlessness and sloth and torpor. You know what it's like. Many of you experience that. You're either, your head is right down, half asleep, but then you put some effort in, and then you're wide awake, but you can't stop thinking. And you calm your thoughts down. Come on, calm it, calm it, calm it. And then your head falls down again. And that was, for me, just very difficult for a while. So one nice thing about being a Buddhist, that you can experiment, try different ways of doing things. Don't always think that you know the best, or you follow your teacher and the teacher knows the best. The teacher probably does know, but maybe not interpreting it correctly. So though with an Ajahn Chah, you could always just experiment, try this and try that, and find out what works. And when I did that, always experimenting, trying things differently, when something did work, I realized that's what he was telling me all along, but I was too stupid to understand it. I always misinterpreted it. So if you are sleepy, be sleepy. As I said yesterday, it's not against precepts to be sleepy. What you're doing is you're being kind to sleepiness. You're not thinking it's some personal failure if you fall asleep or you're dull. You don't think there's something wrong with you, that when they gave brains out at birth, you've got a bad brain, which always is sleeping. You can't meditate. No, be with the sleepiness. Be kind to it. So just a general principle in Buddhism, to respect people with disabilities, people who are different than you, people who you may not agree with, different religions, different races, different genders. Always respect people with the kindness. The door of my heart's open to you. When you respect people like that, it's amazing just how you can contact them and how they can feel that they're welcomed, how they can feel they can relax because you're not going to judge them or throw them away or criticize them or stigmatize them. It's the same with some of your emotions, things like sleepiness. Why do people stigmatize that when they're meditators? So instead, you respect your sleepiness. It has its causes. It's not a personal failure. It's usually because you've been giving out too much, helping out people way too much. And because of that, we're tired. Or like for me yesterday, simple things, like it was so hot today. Today's a cooler day, thank goodness. Yesterday was very boiling. And 41 degrees on my thermometer on my walking path, which is really, really hot. And so there are reasons for sleepiness. And you think that you can overcome that by your willpower. You may be able to overcome it temporarily, but when you don't understand its causes, you find that it wears you out. Fighting sleepiness really drains your energy. So instead, I had the courage to just let sleepiness be. Let it be. Stop fighting things. Be kind to your poor brain, which was overheated, overworked, sleep deprived, or whatever else the cause was. Just to be kind to it. And simple things like kindness, we teach that every day so many times. We teach it, but people don't practice it. When you start practicing kindness to your own sleepiness, oh, it's okay, mind, you can be sleepy. Then what happens is you're not fighting it. You're not making a war with your sleepiness. And what I found was, again, how could a monk like me be so stupid fighting it? When I let it be and was kind to it, I was not wasting my energy. on a battle which I could not win. Instead, I was keeping my energy, preserving it. And as I was preserving my energy, it was growing. And slowly, not as fast as I would have sometimes wanted, but slowly the sleepiness started to vanish. I started to wake up. I started to become more alert, more awake. But instead of going into the restlessness, which when I use willpower, it always ends up with restlessness. When I used kindness, wisdom, power, then the sloth and torpor, when it did disappear, all the mind was really so peaceful, so nice, so at ease. And he had this beautiful space in between restlessness and sleepiness, which was the clarity of the mind. It was mindfulness, awareness in this moment. So I really understood how to overcome sleepiness. And of course, the restlessness, the old monkey mind, of just trying to get this thing done first of all. And why do people just think too much? There's only a certain amount of things you can think about, but I really put the blame, please excuse me, on education. Because I kind of remember that once, when the teacher was looking at me, he said, and my name was a layperson, was Peter. Peter, what are you thinking about that? I said, nothing. I wasn't thinking about anything. I was just at peace with what was being taught. And they thought I was stupid. But if you think about something, then you are smart. And the great thinkers of the world, they're the most intelligent. Oh, I'm glad I'm not a great thinker. Because if I was, I'd be so stressed out. So instead of thinking, we learn how to be more aware and lessen our thoughts. As I think I mentioned during one of the questions yesterday, a great simile of Ajahn Chah is asking us to move all this earth for 3 days, pushing a wheelbarrow in the heat, being bitten by mosquitoes. Oh, that was really tough. But we finished it. And Ajahn Chah went away, and the second monk, Ajahn Liam, took over and said, I think you put the earth in the wrong spot. Move it. Another 3 days of hard work. I was traumatized by that. Didn't have enough time to wash. Your robes were stinky. Because by the time you finished, you were so worn out, you just went to sleep. And after 6 days, hardly any meditation, just work, for long periods of time. And then we moved it after 6 days. Then Ajahn Chah came back. I'm sure that they must have planned this out all along. But he came back and said, I thought I told you to put the earth over that place. Now you put it over this place. Move it. Oh, you think I'm a very peaceful monk, but in those days, if I got angry, I could get angry. I was really upset. I never became a monk to push wheelbarrows of earth in the hot jungles, being bitten by mosquitoes on one meal a day, which wasn't very much anyway, just rice and frogs. I didn't ordain to this. I wanted to become enlightened. I wanted to sit under a tree, not put earth under a tree. Oh, why don't those monks decide where they want that blooming pile of earth? And of course, as I told you yesterday, that's when one of these wonderful monks came up to me. They knew I was upset. And said to me, pushing the wheelbarrow is easy. Thinking about it, that's the hard part. And that's just a beautiful, beautiful piece of wisdom he gave me. Whatever you do in life, thinking about it is the hard part. Doing it is easy. Thinking about organizing a retreat, thinking about starting up a new center, thinking about giving birth, thinking about just dying, whatever you're doing in life, thinking about it is a difficult thing. Doing it is far easier. So it means I didn't value thought so much. Thought was describing the world, but I wanted to experience the world first and think about it afterwards. And after a while, you realize that so much beauty and so much truth in our world is beyond thought. Thinking is sometimes diminishing the experience. You see a beautiful dawn like this morning in Perth. Or you see just, well, a few clouds today. It's going to be a cooler day. Or you see the parrots playing around in the water. Beautiful parrots this time of year, and they get hot too. And they just play around in the water. Thinking about that is very different than actually just sitting there experiencing, giggling as the parrots get all soaking wet. So little by little, you learn how to not think so much and see much more. It's as if your brain has only got a certain capacity. And if you use most of the capacity of your brain for thinking, giving things name, finding out what they mean, where they lead to, where they come from, and all this inner conversation inside of you, you don't have much space in your brain for living, for seeing, for hearing. You can maybe hear some great music. I used to love my music when I was a lay person. And they'd say, what do you think of that? And if I said nothing, they thought that I didn't like it. I said, no, I didn't think anything because I was just enjoying every chord, every note. It was beautiful. But you know, you can't, beautiful, that word can mean so much and describes so little. So it's really, if you've really heard some great music, and saying beautiful, it doesn't really cut it. It's almost being diminishing the experience of great music. Or everything else which is beautiful in your world, in your life, don't give it a name because it lessens the experience. Just enjoy it in silence. And of course, lots of time as a monk, living in the forests, living in mountains, by rivers, by lakes, you can really enjoy the quietness, the stillness, to the point that now I value peace so much. And thinking you only do it when you have to. You know, even doing talks, I've said this many times, but it's absolutely true. I don't know what I'm going to say next. I don't think the talk before I say it. I just allow it to come out. That's one of the reasons why, honestly, some of the things I say, I think that's a bit stupid. But a lot of times what I say, I think, wow, that was really profound. Where did that come from? It's like when you're not thinking about it, it's like a natural unfolding of the Dhamma coming out of your mouth. And some of the things which I've said in my life, I think, where did that come from? That was amazing. Because you don't think about it. It's not planned. It just happens, just like life. And that becomes the most beautiful part of having a quiet mind. And as a monk for so many years, you're inclined to quiet places. I don't know how people can stand going to shopping centers or going to places where there's always so much noise. I was telling the monks yesterday evening, this was my first Christmas back in Bodhiyana Monastery for years and years and years, because I'd always go over usually to Malaysia for the end of the year retreats. I've been doing that for years and years and years. I remember one time when I was doing this meditation retreat in Penang, in Mahindarama Temple. And the room I was staying in just was, you know, next to the road. And so the opposite side of the road, there were houses. They were usually very quiet. But this was Christmas Day or Eve, or one of those days. And in the house opposite, there were some Christians in that house. And they decided to have a Christmas party. Now, you know that when you give talks, especially on retreats, they usually finish 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, after you've done all the questions and answers. And so I went back to my room about 10:15, 10:30, really tired, just wanted to have a nice sleep. And the opposite, the house opposite, they were just getting into their Christmas party, making noise. Now, okay, you know, people have to party, have their noise, that's not a big problem, but they decided to do a karaoke party. And that was the first time I'd heard karaoke. And I hoped I'd never hear it again, because as the clock ticked round and round, 11 o'clock, 11:30, it got louder and louder because they were Christians, they weren't Buddhists, they were drinking lots of alcohol. And so the people were more and more drunk, and the songs were more and more off key and louder. And oh, it was like being in hell, listening to all that karaoke till just past midnight. Because it was like wailing banshees, really loud, off key. And everyone was cheering it. I was moaning in agony. And I always thought after that, you know, there is, for those sorts of people who do very bad things and hurt others, there's a special hell called the karaoke hell for really bad people. And of all the hells which are described in the suttas, that is one hell I wouldn't want to go to at all. The karaoke hell. But anyway, that was just my experience, because I like silence and quiet. So there are the times in my life you go into some really peaceful places. Years ago, I remember going into the center of Thailand, and there was a big forest, and I don't know where it was, but it was almost an idyllic monastery in the center of the jungles. It was cleared. It was a beautiful, not stream, like a river, really a lot of water running through it, in very deep caves. And I remember just asking, can I just go and meditate in one of those caves? And this is so many years ago, almost 45 years ago now, but even that cave, it had been sort of brushed up so there was no dripping water, and had a concrete floor at the end, good air going through it. And it was so silent. And I asked if I could just meditate there for an hour. And the peace on the outside was so strong. And of course, it stopped my mind thinking that you just listen to silence. And of course, that made my brain silent. It was so beautiful, just being peaceful. Mind automatically stopped being restless, because it was resonating with the silence outside. So a lot of times, if you're thinking too much, if you can be in a quiet place, if you find a quiet place, it makes meditation so much easier, because you just listen to the silence outside and take it inside. And the restlessness is just not there. And the longer you stay with a silent mind, the more energy built up. Sloth and Torpor doesn't have a chance with you, because you're too energized. And the other thing which happens is, again, I recall just as a 17-year-old before university, having my gap year before going to university, and traveling through the United States, getting pretty bored with the United States. It's just similar to any other developed country in Europe. And going to Central America, I've seen these photos of these great pyramids in the Yucatan Peninsula of Guatemala. And so I remember just traveling there. And the only way to travel there was, you know, there was no aircraft or buses. You had to go overland and on buses and back of trucks and boats. But I remember taking this boat, you know, from a port, I forget what the port was called, just from Guatemala City to the Caribbean coast, getting on this fishing boat. It was going to take me up the river separating British Honduras, Belize, and Guatemala. But when I was on that boat, I had to leave really, really, really early in the morning, to the point that we saw the sun come up over the Caribbean. I hadn't slept that night, but the sunrise over the Caribbean in 69. The sunrise in 1969 over the Caribbean was absolutely gorgeous. It was so beautiful, I realized there's no way I can fall asleep. I could not miss the beauty. The beauty was captivating and energizing. One of the first times I realized just how beauty just gives you energy. And there's lots of beauty all over the world at any time, not just on the Caribbean coast. In summertime in 1969, anywhere in the world. And if you can start looking at that beauty and noticing it, it does give you enormous energy. And so if you are tired, look at something beautiful, something wonderful in your life, an amazing act of kindness which you've witnessed, or you know, if you're very privileged, one you've done yourself. And if you can notice that kindness and dwell upon it and feel good about it, even bliss out about it, even start crying about it, something wonderful you've done for others. Okay, let's give some example. Even just, I'm still really busy, as you know, as usual, but just, last Sunday, just after my breakfast, someone asked me, there was a disciple, well, I'd never seen her, but she listens to my talks on YouTube in Poland. And she was just about to give birth to a baby in the next couple of days. And her sister, her twin sister, asked me, that would be wonderful. She listens to you all the time. It'd be wonderful if you could find the time to just give my sister a little blessing, a bit of chanting, just say a few words. You can do that now and send it on Skype or something. So of course I did that just after breakfast, in about 5 minutes. And then just yesterday I got an email back, said, oh, she was so touched by that. She never thought that would happen. You know, her teacher she'd never met, at the time she's about to give birth to her first child, that her teacher can find the time, just 5 minutes, to say a few kind words and give some chanting. And said they were crying together, just her sister and her twin sister, the two twins, one who is about to give birth to a kid. And you know, when I hear things like that, it just makes me feel, wow, that's such a nice thing to be able to do. And of course, if I close my eyes now thinking about that, sloth and torpor would have no chance. It would just totally go. And it won't be restless. It'd be this beautiful feeling of having given a little bit of happiness in this world to somebody. That is how to overcome sloth and torpor and overcome restlessness. Just let it be and be kind. More kindness the better. And make this moment beautiful. And this moment is beautiful. Oh, you can't stop looking at it. Of course it's there. You don't get restless. And that's one of the reasons why the most restlessness which people experience is all because they're not enjoying this moment. They've forgotten how to enjoy simplicity. They always want to be entertained, stimulated. But in meditation, we find the more beautiful happinesses of peace. The happinesses of nature, the happiness of stillness. Are we content in this moment? The contentment is the antidote to the first hindrance, which is wanting something. Sometimes they call it sensory desire, but that's only just a part of the first hindrance. Anytime you want something more, want something different, or the second hindrance, want to get rid of what you already have because it's irritating you. It's a wonderful thing to have contentment with whatever you're experiencing. Again, because it's hot weather here in Perth, we have all the flies have finally come out, and there's hundreds of them around. When I go inside my cave, I have to brush the door and just try and keep as many flies out of my cave as possible, because once they're in, they can't get out. But when the flies come, you try and do your best. You can't kill them or anything. But if one comes in, thank God this little icon came on playing music. I wasn't playing music. I was pretending to be a fly. But the internet thought it was music. But anyway, on this one occasion, I was teaching a meditation class about how to deal with flies landing on you. Now, flies in Perth, there's one thing to know about them. They're very clean. They don't carry diseases. There are just so many of them. They're fine. I never found anybody catch any disease from a fly. And sometimes they like to explore. So they go up your nose. Even worse for a monk, sometimes they go in your mouth. And if they go in your mouth in the afternoon and they go down your tummy, you're breaking your precepts because you're not allowed to eat in the afternoon. I've eaten many flies unintentionally. They don't taste nice, but they just, you open your mouth and they're in and they can't get out and they just go down unintentionally. But what can you do? But anyway, on this occasion, I had my mouth closed and I was meditating and I was teaching other people what happens when a fly lands on you. Just let it be. It's doing no harm. Problem is, I have to live my teachings. So just after I said that, and this was recorded, it's another problem with my life, that everything is recorded so people find out if I'm practicing what I preach. And so a fly came, bzz, 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 and landed under my nose and stayed there. Now, if there wasn't a camera on me, I'd have flicked it away. Or try to blow it away. I couldn't do that. It was recorded. And I just said about just, you know, let it be. So I had to practice what I preach. So I let the fly be. And I found out later on that that actually was a Buddhist fly. And I'll show you why I knew it was a Buddhist fly afterwards. Because after just staying just under my nose for a little while, then it started to walk around my mouth. It went around. And I discovered in my meditation, I discovered when a fly is here, it doesn't sort of irritate so much. It's irritating, but not so much. But when it comes to, what was it, to here, these two places are the most irritating, the most sensitive. So once it got past this place, that wasn't so bad. It went around. When it came to here, we go again. It was really sort of tickly. And then it went round. And it went round three times. That's why I knew it was a Buddhist. Circumambulation. You go around stupas three times. And circumambulating your mouth. What very spiritual fly. It was a Buddhist fly. And so it went round three times. And after it did the third round, then it flew off. Because that's why I knew it was paying respects to me, that's all. That's what I thought anyway. Why not add something positive to an irritating experience? But what you realize, Sarah, is the restlessness will become when you think too much, when you try to control the experience. If I had blown it off, then the fly would have gone around and then come and landed back again. As flies do, bzz, 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 and then come straight back again. Fly off, bzz, 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 and land back again. You'd have to endure it for longer. Just by being at peace with it, being kind with it, being gentle. It did what it needed to do. There was no food there. And so it flew away and left me at peace. And I thought that this is how we deal with restlessness. If your mind is restless, wants to think about something, you say, no, meditation is the most important time now, and it doesn't work, then try another strategy. The other strategy is asking your mind what it wants to do. Remember at the beginning of the guided meditation, I always asked you to ask your parts of your body, how are you? What do you want to do? Legs, how are you? Hands, are you comfortable? So ask your mind what it wants to do. Do you want to be peaceful or is there some thought you want to do? And sometimes if my mind wants to do some thought and then I realize, well, it's not really necessary, but my mind really wants to do it. I said, okay, off you go. You can think if you want. So my mind does a little bit of thinking and then it realizes it's a waste of time. And it's like my mind comes back to me and said, I'm sorry, but what do you want to do, Ajahn Brahm? I said, let's meditate. And I said, okay. So this is how we work in harmony together. I don't treat my mind like a slave, like a maid, always telling it what to do and scolding it when it doesn't do right. You always do it with beautiful kindness. So if your mind just wanders off, you go with it. You don't just, let's say you're going to the wrong places, come back again. Be kind to your mind, be a friend to your mind. Say it wanders off, you wander with it. So it means you're always there next to your mind. That's the way to overcome restlessness. You're not restless. This simile came when people used to ask me, aren't you tired, Ajahn Brahm, when you go traveling, always go from one country to another in aircraft? And I looked at that, I contemplated, and I said, actually, I don't travel. I don't go anywhere. The plane does the moving, the aircraft does all the traveling. I just do the sitting. I sit down in the chair, close my eyes, meditate, and then the plane just does all the moving. I just do the sitting. And if you understand that simile, you understand just how to overcome a lot of restlessness. The mind is moving, I'm with it all the way. I may start off in one country and end up in another country, but I don't travel at all. Always here in this moment, being here. And then you find the restlessness is not there. Because you're always here. Restlessness is more the attitude. I don't want to be here, I want to be somewhere else. That's the heart of restlessness, not wanting to be here. Why do you not want to be here? You are here. It's just, fighting the obvious truth of now. So after a while, I try to bring more contentment into this moment. Maybe not be the best, may not be the coolest place, to give a talk for all the wonderful people in the BGF and AIPASICO and the BF and the Bodhiyana Singapore and anyone else who's listening in. But it's more than good enough. It's that feeling of this is good enough. Not that it's perfect, but it's good enough. That starts my restlessness. I can sit here and be at peace. So you make peace with this moment. You don't expect peace to be here. You make peace with this. Of course, many of you know that that is straight from the second factor of the Eightfold Path, Samasankhapa. Make peace, be kind, be gentle. It's a very soft and beautiful translation of the second part of the Buddha's Eightfold Path. Make peace, be kind, be gentle. That overcomes restlessness very easily. You're making peace with this moment, you've got no business, no fighting, nothing to do. You're here just if you're traveling, the mind is moving somewhere, but you're always here right with it. You're at peace with it. You're kind to it and gentle with it. What happens is after a while, just because you're always with this mind, the mind likes you. It doesn't run away from you. For years and years and years, when I was thinking, why is the mind restless? Why does it disappear from me? Because the obvious answer was because me and my mind had a bad attitude towards one another. I was always trying to control it. So it couldn't stand me. It always wanted to run away. And it ran away, I'd bring it back in. Come on, come back, watch your breath. It'd run away again, I'd catch it again, come back. We weren't supposed to scold it, but I said, come on, mind, you can do better than this. It was scolding. And after a while, I said, okay, what about off you go. With my permission, with my kindness. And then the mind never wanted to run away again. It's like the mind thought that this monk is very kind to me. Who would want to run away from him? So my mind stayed with me. So the mindfulness became still. So we add the kindness, whatever you're doing in your meditation, just be kind to this moment. Contentment comes very, very easily. With kindness and contentment, you never want to go anywhere. The mind stays. And I'm talking about staying. I did say something about the fifth hindrance, about the doubt the other day when I gave the simile of being lost in the mountains in northern Scotland and following something which I knew was leading in the right direction. If you're meditating and you find your awareness is increasing, your kindness, your sense of relaxation, your inner peace, outer peace, everything is improving, you're going in the right direction. Carry on. It doesn't have to be Ajahn Brahm method or any method. If it's going in the right direction, it's the Buddha's method. So just keep following that one. And now, as far as restlessness are concerned, now is the time for going with the flow time. It's toilet time. So all of you who wish to go off into the toilets and just relieve the burdens of life, the suffering inside your bladder and other places, now's a good time to do that. May your bladders be happy and well, be free, and realize the bliss of emptiness. Toilet break. Okie dokie. I'm back again in 5 minutes to do the guided meditation. This is a little story on the side for those who have not gone to the toilet. That the first year I was at Bodhiyana Monastery, that was 35, 36 years ago, I was staying, the hut I had was like an A-frame. It was really hot inside, really boiling hot in the summertime. No air conditioners or no sort of electricity even in that hut. So one really hot afternoon, I thought, wow, this is terrible. It's very hard to meditate, sweating all over the place. So just I went down the hill to the ablution block. And I thought, it's tiles inside, and it's one of the coolest buildings in the monastery. So I went into one of the shower cubicles, because I knew that monks would not usually shower at that time. There's only a few monks out at the time. So I went and thought, this is a beautiful place to meditate. So I sat on the tile floor, it's all so much cooler than my hut, and started to meditate. And it was very peaceful for about 5 minutes, until another monk decided he wasn't going to go to the shower, he was going to go to the toilet. And the noises which come out from a toilet cubicle were so gross, there's no way I could carry on meditating. So I tried my best to find a quiet place, but in a toilet cubicle, when there's lots of noisy monks, that wasn't the best place. But anyway, I tried. It's cool though, very cool. A little bit smelly, but I can deal with it. How are the people coming back from the toilet now? is it time to carry on?
On their way.
On their way, excellent.
We have about 40 that showed up in the Hyatt venue today.
Oh, only 40? How many yesterday?
Less, I think, because people were either zooming in from their rooms or their homes. But we had a total of 227 from Bodhiyana, Singapore.
Okay, that's good. Total. So is the numbers getting less or getting more? otherwise, you give me the sack if they go down.
According to BGF, there is a total of over 500 registrations, but we're seeing at any time, over 300 signing in. So we're just doing it at their convenience.
So what is my sales target?
None.
Well, we've got one. We've got one nun. We have one nun here. I saw her yesterday. So I fulfilled my sales target. A nun.
Yeah, Venerable Damadina.
Yeah, nice to see her.
Where are you from, Venerable Damadina? Someone can unmute her.
You can unmute her.
Yeah, can you unmute?
I have to look for her.
Oxford, UK.
Oh, right.
Ooh.
From England.
Yeah.
Middle of the night here.
Are you very cold. Are you in Oxford right now?
Yes, I live here.
Oh, wow. You know Venerable Chandesh, because she's in Oxford too.
Yes, not very well, only over the internet. I don't go anywhere.
Oh.
I'm very happy in my little room, don't worry.
Oh, okay, excellent. It's nice to see you. And again, it's 2 o'clock in the morning there. Wow, yeah. That's excellent.
I got up at 10 last night.
Oh, I'm very honoured you got up that early.
I'm the one who's honoured.
Yeah, well, if you're very cold, just think that out here, 40 degrees, that's 106 or something yesterday. 106 degrees Fahrenheit, it's crazy temperature.
20 years in Sri Lanka.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, well, I like the heat.
Right, okay. Well, this is extreme heat. So it's Sri Lanka gets 30, 35 or something, but when it gets over 40, that's when you start to melt. Anyway, great to see you. Thank you for coming. So you've made me meet my sales target of nun.
Yes, I am a nun.
Yes,
nothing.
Exactly.
Nothing.
Okie dokie. So we could start doing the guided meditation.
Yes, all good to go. Thank you.
Very good. Excellent. Not all good to go, all good to stop. Yeah. And stop going anywhere, just to be. So, closing the eyes. And going through the body scan is helpful, because very few people have problems with restlessness or sloth and torpor when they're going through the body. Feelings in the body are easier to get to know, something we can focus on. When you go into the mind, that's a little bit more subtle. And it's usually when you go into the mind that people have restlessness or sloth and torpor. But right now, just be with your body. And how are your legs right now? Because I was talking, couldn't feel the legs. I was not paying any attention to them. And now my full attention goes to the legs and the feet. Right, far apart now. I did see on the internet, it's called man spreading. I'm not doing man spreading today, I'm doing monk spreading. My feet feel comfortable like this. I'm not taking up anybody else's space. My feet have all the space they want. I just have this attitude towards my body at this time to make peace, be kind, be gentle. Especially the gentleness to your own body. Gentleness to my toes, to my heels. I just go all the way up my calves, my knees. I don't know why they don't have problems with my knees, because so many other people do, but I look at my knees, I'm still kind to them, even though they don't cause me any trouble. May my knees be happy and well. When I say such things, I really mean it. I don't do these things superficially. I give kindness, peace, gentleness, and give it full on. And then I can feel that part of my body reacting with this extra relaxation. I thought they were relaxed before, but now my knees are more relaxed. And my thighs, often I think there's no problem there, but I still give them kindness and peace. So the body feels comfortable. Slow legs. Ooh, so at ease. And I get to know the mindfulness, what it keeps watching, it gets to be quite, what's it called, sensitive to, and becomes an expert in that field. People like, it's a bad simile, but like tasting wine, they become such a very sensitive palate, and they can tell where the wine was made, its year, and all sorts of stuff. Of course, I don't do that with wine, but I do that with my body. You're very sensitive, and I know how my body is feeling because I've looked at my body for such a long time. You get to know it and understand it. Then I go to my butt. It's not really comfortable. I thought I was just going to leave it alone for a short meditation, but I'm going to move. Yeah, that's better. Until the legs and the butt are really nicely balanced. And there was an unpleasant pressure on my butt before, but now that's not there. The movement was done out of kindness and it achieved its goal of comfort. I'll take my back to give it a good old stretch. Oh, I love that stretch. Oh, I needed that. Once the back is stretched, I have a choice to lean against the backrest of the chair or keep it straight. And today, it feels good being straight. So I've moved it away from the backrest. It feels great, so fine. Then I go to the front of my body. I pick up as many sensations as I can on the front of my body, especially my colon and intestines. I feel them. I feel sensations in there. When I come to any place which is a bit tight or aching, I just pause and I just allow it to relax to the max, give it so much kindness. Poor old intestines, you work so hard. Focusing on someone and caring for them makes them feel better. That's why we visit people in hospital when they're sick. So someone visited us, that uplifts us. If you know, you visit your intestines. In other words, it may sound silly, but you ask, how are you down there? And they get feel better. You go to your stomach, all that breakfast inside. Actually, most of the things gone down to the intestines now. My lungs and my heart. All those organs in the back, the liver and the kidneys. They're usually very quiet. If I find any tightness or tension or ache or anything there, I don't try and capture the feeling with words. I just know it and are kind to it. It's like, you know, I know some people are just so, so kind, even though maybe of different religions. Even though they can't even speak to me because they have a different language. Still, they're so kind. They relate to me with that warmth of metta. That's how I relate to my body. Looking at my tummy with lots and lots and lots of kindness. May you be happy and well. My lungs, may you be happy and well. My heart, may you be at peace, heart. All the blood vessels, allowing everything to be at ease. I enjoy doing this, so delightful. Looking after your body. So it always responds by feeling that little bit more at ease and comfortable. I go to my shoulders. And they're always, I don't know why this happens, but they're always tense when I start. So I just learn how to relax them. Like things being pulled on each end, and I let go of each end. Allow things to be natural, at ease. I'm not pushing them, squashing them. Allowing them just to be at ease. There's no job they have to do. So they can just take it easy for this time. And go down my arms, elbows, and wrists, and hands. Yeah, once again, I thought my hands were okay, but they're not. But I focus on them and ask them, hands, are you comfortable? They answer me saying, no, please move us. And this is not just being schizophrenic and hearing sounds. This is just a way of describing, you know, being sensitive and mindful to, in this case, the feelings in my hands. If I can make them more comfortable, I will do that. That's how much you care. It costs me nothing. It doesn't disturb me at all. And my hands become really at ease. And I go up to my shoulders and neck again. Making sure, again, the head is balanced on top of the neck. I've seen people with some really weird postures. The head is just too far forward or too far back. If you're really striving for something, sometimes people have their head really lifted up high. Just keep it natural, not low down, not ultra high, just comfortable. When that's your goal, just have this comfortable neck muscles. Nothing more than that, just physical comfort and ease. You're going in the right direction. Your doubt should be overcome that this is the best posture because it feels good. You go to your face. All the muscles around my eyes and mouth and forehead, but my forehead doesn't really have much problem. But if you have like stress on your forehead, just be aware of those muscles on your forehead. Do a bit of trial and error until you can relax both ends of those muscles. So they're not pulled tight like a guitar string. They're loose, like a coil of string on the ground. Not being pushed or pulled or stretched. Sometimes those strings are stretched to almost breaking point. You feel that in your life sometimes. Let go of both ends. Not trying to achieve anything in the future, not being held back by the past. You're free. So the muscles can totally be at ease and relax. But you know, I still haven't got names for those muscles and those feelings. I know the experiences without giving them a name. I recognize them. To me, the names are not so important. Then I can feel my whole body sitting here. Once again, now I'm honest with you, it feels really good. I'm not leaning against a chair today, I'm not sitting up straight. It still feels good. And I wait until I can experience a delight in a relaxed body. Because I'm experiencing that delight right now, that means that it's easy to be mindful of my body. It's fun. It's joyful. It's attractive. That's why I keep looking at my body. Feel it, the whole of it. Peace at ease. I know what it's like if you're really sick and your body's tight and tense or bruised or something. Painful, and it's hard to find a comfortable position. When you're meditating, this is comfort. I appreciate and value it. First thing which I put in my jar is the comfort of the body. Once that jar is comfortable, sorry, once that body is comfortable, just automatically, it tends to be not of interest, and you go into the mind, the peaceometer. And again, I've looked at peace for such a long time, and it's just so valuable to me. One of the most important things in the world. My mind is at peace. I can do so much more afterwards, to do my duties, to serve and to help, build monasteries, talk to people, solve problems. You can do it well. So peace is the foundation of kindness and wise actions. So my peaceometer is so essential. You know from experience how to move the reading of the peaceometer closer and closer to deep peace. Whatever peace you feel now, how wonderful it is, how joyful. It feels good. It's like a jewel, so valuable, so delightful. Simple, but you can look at it and appreciate it. Peace. Wow. So few people know peace. You're getting to know her. Getting to know her so deeply. How wonderful peace is. You find that almost happens automatically. When you're really into peace, you're really enjoying it, you find there is no past or future. It only lives in the now, peace. And you can't really give it a name. A deep experience of peace and allowing peace just to go all around you, cover you like a doona in the bed. They can embrace you despite the fragrance of the flowers in the garden. Give you this beautiful feeling of safety. You don't need to be a monkey and get things out of the way. You have peace here. Restlessness, where on earth has that gone? Sloth and torpor. And there is something so beautiful and delightful as peace. You can't become dull. You should have something which is enjoyable to watch. Not just enjoyable for the sense of delight in itself, but because this is profoundly enjoyable, like a pure happiness. And the doubt that is this the right way? It feels good. And it leads to deep peace, truth and realization. If that's all you ever learn on this retreat, what is peace? Not as a theory, but as an experience. Beautiful peace of now. Please stay with her. Whatever the mind does as it changes. Don't try and control the mind. Just travel with her. It's like going on an aircraft. The plane does the moving. You just do the sitting. And be quiet for 2 minutes.
Just appreciating a bit of light, peacefulness. Can experience that joy. Then restlessness, sloth and torpor doesn't have a chance. Being content. Be content with this moment. This is good enough. If you want something more, you cannot enjoy what you already have. Enjoying what you already have right now is an important factor of going deeper. So it's now close to the end of this meditation period. How do you feel? What's it like inside, first of all? How peaceful are you? What does peace feel like? Will you get to know peace? Like you're tasting a morsel of incredibly delicious food. You don't swallow it straight away. You let it stay in your mouth so your taste buds can fully experience it. It's like peace. Let it stay in your mind. So you get to know her, it becomes a dear friend. And as you start to come out of your meditation, it's like you're coming from inside to the outside. You can feel your body. Body which has been looking after you sitting still. It feels even more delightful than when I left it. Relax at ease. It's still. And now you may open your eyes if you wish to finish this brief guided meditation. Before you move any other part of your body, please smile at the end of every meditation. I love doing that. It's like brings the happiness from inside and just brings a lot of it into your body. Oh, okay. Thank you for giving me the privilege of talking to you and giving you the meditation today. Okay. I've got to start going downstairs now for the morning dana. If I'm late, then the other monks can't start eating yet. So to keep them happy, I'd better go now. And I'll see you this afternoon. Or this afternoon, this evening. Well, sometime anyway. Bye.